again, church family. My name is Josh Fields. I am the lead pastor here at First, and I just want to thank you for welcoming me into your home and welcoming us into your home again this Sunday. The title of my sermon this morning is Divorce and Remarriage, which, as you know, is every pastor's dream text to preach via live stream. I want you to know, behind preaching this text this morning, if you're curious as to the why, let me just give you a little clue. Here at First, we believe that God builds His church through His Word. And so we believe in taking in the entire counsel of God as we walk verse by verse through books of the Bible. And when we listen to God's word in faith, and then we step out in obedience, God builds a strong and healthy church that brings glory to Himself and that's on fire to reach the lost. And so that's why we go verse by verse through the Bible. And so this morning we find ourselves in Matthew chapter 5, verses 31 and 32, looking at the topic Jesus discusses, which is divorce and remarriage. Now, I want to kind of preface this with three thoughts. First, in general about the Sermon on the Mount, then in specific about our passage, and then my heart to you as your pastor. So first, the Sermon on the Mount is King Jesus's edict to His people about how they are to live, their actions and their attitudes. It's important to realize that Jesus isn't just concerned with our outward action, but He's also jealous to transform our internal desires. It may not feel like it in the moment, but the reality is when we deny our sinful flesh and we lean into Christ's commands for us in obedience, there's great joy in that. And what we find in the Sermon on the Mount in general, to be a follower of Jesus means complete and utter surrender. So I hope this morning, as we look at our text, as we approach it, we come with a surrendered heart. Secondly, in regards to our passage in specific, I believe that we have complicated divorce and remarriage, not because it's so hard to understand, but truthfully because it's hard to accept. So right now, what I want you to do is just spend just a moment, maybe 5-10 seconds in your heart with the Lord and ask Him to give you an accepting heart. Would you do that, please? And then finally, my heart for you as your lead pastor is not to condemn you this morning. It's not to weigh you down with sorrow. I know that many, if not all of us, have been touched in some way by divorce. My goal this morning is to be faithful in sharing God's word. And my heart for you is that you would do as James 1:21 says, that you would receive with meekness the implanted word which is able to save your souls. The truth is, some of you this morning will feel the conviction of the ways you've fallen short. Some of you, your part in that is to receive the word of God, right? To receive it. If you feel that conviction this morning from the Lord, I pray that you would respond in repentance and faith. And with the assurance that in Christ you are loved with an unbreakable love of, with the unbreakable love of God. You can't separate that. You will not separate from Him. He will not separate Himself from you. So just know that. So let's pray, and then we'll look at our text this morning. Father, we just ask that you would be with us this morning, God, that you would speak through your text. Father, we know that this is a difficult passage for us. Pretty simple to understand, pretty difficult to accept. So give us willing hearts to receive your word. And give us the meekness and the humility and the ability to move forward in it. God, we love you and we pray these things in Christ's name. Amen. So if you haven't yet, I want you to join me in Matthew chapter 5. We'll be in verses 31 and 32 this morning. Jesus speaking, and He says, "It was also said, whoever divorces his wife, let him give her a certificate of divorce. But I say to you that everyone who divorces his wife, except on the ground of sexual immorality, makes her commit adultery, and whoever marries a divorced woman commits adultery. Now, my sermon has 4 points this morning, and we'll begin with the first one, which is the teaching of the scribes and the Pharisees. Just like Jesus' teaching on anger and then his teaching on lust, Jesus points to the teaching of the scribes and the Pharisees in order to make a point. In verse 31, he says, "It was also said, whoever divorces his wife, let him give her a certificate of divorce." Now, what you need to understand is that during this time in history, the dominant view from the scribes and the Pharisees was that a husband could divorce his wife for any and all reasons. This was basically known as the school of Hillel, and we actually see this in Matthew 19, verse 3. In Matthew 19, verse 3, a Pharisee comes up to tempt Jesus, and he says this. A Pharisee came up to him, that is Jesus, and tested him, asking him, "Is it lawful to divorce one's wife for any reason?" See, the scribes and Pharisees basically thought that anything a wife did to displease her husband was worthy of divorce. And this was a faulty interpretation of Deuteronomy chapter 24, verses 1 through 4. In their writings known as the Mishnah, the Pharisees' writings known as the Mishnah, they made hundreds of reasons why you could divorce your wife and why a woman would be worthy of divorce. And one of the things I noticed is it's not a two-way street. In their writings, it was just the man who could divorce his wife for all these reasons. But I just thought, hey, let me read a few of these reasons why they could do this at that time. First, if the wife was lazy, she was worthy of divorce. I think it's a good thing that they didn't have TV or social media during that time, right? A lot of people would be in trouble. Secondly, one of the things they said is, if your wife had a funny-shaped head, and I quote, wedge-shaped, turnip-shaped, or hammer-shaped. Now, I've got a picture I want you to see. Picture of some beets or some turnips. I'm just saying, if her head was shaped like a turnip, did he not notice before he married her? Look, I'm not a detective, but that would have been hard to miss. I mean, come on. Another reason you could dismiss your wife and divorce her during that time was if her in-laws moved into the same city. Ouch. Kind of the last one I picked out that I thought was interesting is, if your wife burned your supper, she was worthy of divorce. Talk about intense. Now look, we hear those reasons why they could divorce their wife during that time, and we find it comical, right? It's kind of funny. And the reason we find it that way is because we do what C.S. Lewis termed as, we fall into this category. We commit the fallacy of chronological snobbery, which basically means that since we were born after those people, right? We believe that we're smarter, we're more civilized, and we're more advanced than they were. That's why it's comical to us. But I want you to think about this. In our culture, our enlightened culture, we don't even need a reason to divorce. We call this no-fault divorce. And simply put, to the Pharisees and scribes and to our no-fault divorce-plagued culture, Jesus basically says, you are not to divorce. Right? He gives one exclusion to that. He gives one exception. And then he says, here's why. And he does that with a negative outcome. He shows us the negative outcome of divorce. But before we think about the negative outcome, I want us to think about our second point, and that is the divine design of marriage. The Bible's teaching on divorce cannot be understood without understanding the Bible's teaching on marriage. Listen to the divine pattern from Genesis 2, 24. In the garden, we read this. It says, "Therefore, a man shall leave his father and his mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh." I want you to notice three things about this passage. First, marriage is God's design. It is not man's. Which means, in the deepest way, every couple that has ever been married for the history of the world, whether they are Christian or not, have participated in a union established by our Creator. It doesn't matter what Washington may say, marriage is God's design. And because of that, because it's his design, that means he defines the nature and scope of marriage, which leads to the second thing that flows from Genesis 2:24, which is this: marriage is intended to last a lifetime. It has been built for permanence. The man shall leave his father and mother, and then notice, they shall hold fast. He should hold fast to his wife. It carries the idea, holding fast carries the idea of a gluing together, right? It's meant to last. In Matthew 19, which we will see in the months to come, Jesus says it this way: "What therefore God has joined together, let not man separate." From the beginning, the divine design of marriage is that a man and a woman would be united, and that togetherness, that marriage, would last till death do us part. And then thirdly, I want us to notice that in God's divine design, marriage creates a one flesh union. In marriage, a man and a woman are so closely joined that they become one flesh, which basically means it involves spiritual and physical oneness. The physical oneness, the intimacy, is expressed in sex, and the spiritual intimacy is cultivated in prayer and worship. And this oneness, this one flesh union, is protected by the permanence of the covenant. Therefore, since God created marriage to be an intimate one flesh union that's to last forever until death do us part, divorce on the deepest level destroys the union that God himself made. Now, I just want to say this with great compassion and pastoral care. The union of marriage is one which God, as its creator, never intends to be broken. He never desires it to be broken. Divorce is a denial. It's a denial of his will. It's a destruction of his work. Now, we're about to look at verse 32, where we find what my third point is entitled, the exception clause. But before we look at that, here's what I want to say. It's important to recognize right now that God never commands divorce. He never endorses divorce, and he never blesses divorce. He understands that we live in a culture that is fallen, a post-fall world. We live in a world racked with sin, and we live in a culture where divorce is incredibly common. Because he knows that, he never blesses divorce, but he does offer relief for those who've experienced the hurt of adultery. So let's look at verses 31 and 32 again together. It says, "It was also said," Jesus says, "whoever divorces his wife, let him give her a certificate of divorce. But I say to you that everyone who divorces his wife, except on the ground of sexual immorality, makes her commit adultery. And whoever marries a divorced woman commits adultery." Look, guys, it's God's plan that a husband and wife remain married. But he does teach that divorce is permissible in one circumstance. This is what we commonly call the exception clause. Sexual immorality is the biblical permissible way that a spouse can pursue a divorce. Even though in the passage Jesus is addressing the men, this is important to understand, Jesus is addressing the husband, this actually applies to both the wife and the husband. Sexual immorality, which could be translated as adultery, is the exception that Jesus makes for divorce. But that said, just let me encourage you, Jesus does not command or even bless divorce, even in the face of adultery. He only permits it. Rather, God desires there to be healing in our marriages. Our God is a God of reconciliation. He always desires for us to come back together. Look, adultery is a heartbreaking sin, and I do not want to minimize that this morning. But what I want you to see is that when we divorce, we eradicate something God has made. Christ desires genuine reconciliation as far as it is possible. His heart for us, if your spouse be willing, is that you would come back together. And that is what the gospel portrays, is it not? That we should do in our marriage, God in sending Jesus to live the life we couldn't live and die the death we deserve and rise from the grave. He delights in putting our souls that are broken back into order. He delights in transferring us from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of light. Jesus is in the business of saving our souls. And our God, Jesus, who saves our souls, who's in that business, is also in the business of putting broken marriages and broken homes back together. Look, marriage is not easy, right? Ask my wife. It's not an easy thing. It's hard work, but it's worthwhile work. I want you to think about this. What better tells of the gospel of Christ than the rescuing gospel, the gospel that says Jesus loves us despite our failings, than when a husband and a wife reconcile after something hard? Now let's review. God's design in marriage is this. He created it. It's his idea. It's a one flesh union that's to last a lifetime, right? But he never blesses divorce, but he gives a permissible reason for it, for those who've experienced the pain of adultery. And the Bible does add one more reason in 1 Corinthians chapter 7. Paul, writing to the church in Corinth, tells us that a Christian who is abandoned by his or her unbelieving spouse can let them go. That's the other exception to this rule of married for life. Now, we're going to deal with that later in Matthew chapter 19, so we won't deal with it in detail here, but just know there is that exception as well. But I want you to notice from the text that Jesus's argument is actually different than mine. See, I've made the argument that based on God's divine design for marriage, we're not to divorce. Jesus doesn't make that argument here. He actually says, you shouldn't divorce, and he connects it to the passage from last week. And he says, you shouldn't divorce because there's a negative outcome that happens. Because when you divorce, remarriage happens, and that actually works to multiply adultery. I'm gonna look back at verse 32. Jesus says this, but I say to you that everyone who divorces his wife, except on the ground of sexual immorality, makes her commit adultery. And whoever marries a divorced woman commits adultery. Remember last week we looked at verses 27 and following, and we talked about how the Pharisees and the scribes touted in pride their ability to stay out of bed with other women. And Jesus looked at that and he said, wait, let me get at the heart of that. See, lust is adultery of the heart, and you stand condemned because of that. And now, again, he indicts the scribes and Pharisees for adultery because they were committing it by making it legal to divorce on almost any reason. The ease of divorce was making it possible for them to avoid open adultery. But Jesus, what he does is confront them with the true meaning of the law. Outside of Jesus' exception for sexual immorality, and Paul's exception found in 1 Corinthians chapter 7, the abandonment of a non-believing spouse, Jesus says everyone who divorces his wife makes her commit adultery, and whoever marries a divorced woman commits adultery. Jesus shows us that every time a man, without proper cause, turns his wife loose in divorce to remarry, he forces his wife into adultery, and in extension, he makes himself guilty. Now think about the culture during that time. The reason a divorce in that culture would force a woman into adultery is because they had to remarry for survival purposes. Women during that time almost always needed a husband to survive. And so when a man divorced his wife for any reason other than adultery, it caused her to have to remarry, thus forcing her into the act of adultery. But Jesus doesn't stop there. He also says, in addition, a man who marries the former wife and a woman who marries the former husband are likewise guilty of adultery. Look, to round it off, Jesus says, whoever marries a divorced woman commits adultery. And this is what he means. any marriage that includes a second marriage for either spouse, if the divorce didn't stem from sexual immorality or Paul's exception in 1 Corinthians 7, then the second marriage begins with the act of adultery. The new marriage begins initially with adultery, but it's not perpetually adulterous. See, the scribes and Pharisees, through their faulty interpretation of the Old Testament law, were causing adultery to multiply. Jesus' entire point in this passage, his entire argument in this passage, is that divorce leads to adultery. That is what he's saying. Now, I want you to listen closely. According to Jesus, a man or a woman who has no biblical right to divorce has no right to remarry, because to do so would initiate an entire chain of adultery, because remarriage after an unbiblical divorce results in sinful and adulterous relationships for all involved. That's the reasoning Jesus uses here in this passage for staying married. If these two verses were a math problem, it would read like this. Divorce plus remarriage equals adultery, barring the two exceptions found in Scripture. Okay, so Jesus is not holding any punches back, is he? And he just comes right out and says it. But the truth is, it's not that this is so hard to understand, as it is hard to accept. And my question for us this morning is, will we accept the words of our master? Will we accept the words of Christ? I want to end with a few practical inferences for you, kind of a few practical thoughts to different groups of people. How do we move forward? How do we live in light of this massively difficult truth in a culture where divorce is so common? Well, first, I want to speak to my singles. By single, I mean those who've never married, including children, students, and adults, or those who've been divorced for biblical reasons or not, to my singles. First, let me say this. If you're single, you are not of lesser value in the eyes of God. It is not more spiritual to be married, just as it's not more spiritual to be single. In fact, think about the founder of our religion, Jesus Christ himself. He was single. And then the one who wrote most of the New Testament, Paul, was most likely single. You are not of lesser value because you're single. Secondly, let me say this. If you do plan on getting married one day, which I think most of you probably do, Lord willing, after hearing these words from Christ, let me give you this encouragement. It is of utmost importance that you pick your spouse well. It is the most important thing you can do in your dating and engagement relationships is to pick well, right? Those who you date, you fall in love with, and those you fall in love with, you marry. And so you better be picky or choosy when it comes to those you date. You want to find someone who loves the Lord like you do, someone who's pursuing Christ like you do, because listen to the words of Jesus. That person that you choose and you're going to spend your life with, they better love Christ like you do, because you're in it for the long haul. That's what Christ wants for you. So to the singles, that's what I want to say. To the married, if you're married, let me say this. Value your marriage. Stay true to the promises you made on your wedding day. Right now, I want you to look at your spouse, okay? Look at your spouse. And I want you to take turns saying this to each other. First, look at your spouse and repeat after me. Divorce is not allowed. It will not be an option for us. Look at your spouse right now and tell them that. Divorce is not allowed. It will not be an option for us. Okay? Keep looking at them. Look them in their eyes. Right? Stare deep into their souls. And then say this. I will stay true to you. I will be faithful. Say that to them. I will stay true to you. I will be faithful. And then finally, I want you to look at your spouse and I want you to tell them this. In the tough times, I will be as committed as I am in the good times. Say that to them. In the tough times, I will be as committed as I am in the good times. And why? Why would we make these promises to each other? Well, because this is what our King asks of us. And our King who gave his life for us, would we not give our life for him? Would we not live our life to please him? How could we tell him no? Two other thoughts for my married folk, and even if you're single as well. Two ways that you can love those who have been through divorce. I got this from John Piper's book, This Momentary Marriage, and I thought it was really good. John Piper says this, if you know someone who's been divorced and you want to walk, here's two things that you can do for them. Number one, come alongside them. Stand with them as they walk through repentance and help them find their way through the transitions that they're going through. Help them, love them, support them, pray for them, walk with them during this season. And then secondly, as you walk through this with them, continue to hold dear the design of marriage. Continue to articulate the design of marriage. Do all you can, short of sin, to help the people you know around you stay away from divorce. It may feel loving in the moment to make excuses and to encourage someone in the short time to make an allowance for divorce. But I'm telling you, though it may feel okay in the moment and may feel better in the long run, in the decades to come, that will wreak havoc on our country and, more importantly, on our church. And so Piper says, walk beside those who've experienced the pain of divorce and continue to hold a conviction for the design of marriage, remarriage, and divorce. Now I want to speak to those who've experienced divorce. To those who are in this category, few things are more painful than divorce. My guess is the mere mention of this word carries a huge weight of sorrow and loss, tragedy, disappointment, guilt, anger, fear, resentment. It's a horrible thing. I'm sure this message has been so hard to hear. Thank you for listening. If you're still listening, thank you. God bless you for receiving the word with meekness. The pain of the past is hard. None of us can go back and change it. If we could hop in a time machine, everyone I know would hop in a time machine and go to the past and change some things in their life that have happened. But we can't. We can't go back there. We have to live today. We have to live now and deal with life in the presence, in the present. If you've been divorced, look at me. You have not committed the unforgivable sin. You're not a second-class Christian. You are loved by God. God has a wonderful now, and he has a wonderful future for you. He is going to use you in ways you cannot imagine. And so my encouragement for you is just to believe that, to lean into that, that you are not second-rate. You are not second-class. You have not committed an unforgivable sin. God wants to use you in incredible ways. And so lean in to what God has for you. Now, the last group of people of those who've been divorced and remarried, I'd like to speak to you. And your remarriage falls into the category of what Jesus has talked about, which is the category of adultery. It is true, if that's you, your new marriage was initially adulterous, but it is not continually adulterous. This means, yes, you do have reason to go to God and to repent and ask for forgiveness. And yes, you do have reason to go to your former spouse and make restoration, make amends as far as it is possible, right? But I want to say this. Do not, I repeat, do not divorce your current spouse and try to reunite with your previous spouse. Do not do that. your marriage may have begun with adultery, but it doesn't continue this way. The calling on your life now is to live with your spouse faithfully today and in the future until you are separated by death. Commit daily to lifelong faithfulness. Model the difference Christ has made in your life and is making in your marriage. Do not excuse your past sins, right? Don't excuse them. Don't excuse your past failures. Acknowledge them, confess them, repent of them, and then move forward in the grace and forgiveness of Jesus Christ. You know, I was watching The Lion King this past week and the cartoon version, and Rafiki said to grown-up Simba, he said this, "Oh yes, the past can hurt, but the way I see it, you can either run from it or you can learn from it." To those who've been divorced and remarried, will you, with great humility and trust in Christ, learn from the past and move together with your spouse today and into the future with fresh hope, every day living to honor Christ? You know, church, we do have hope, don't we? I mean, we sing often at our church on Christ, the solid rock I stand. Our hope is found in nothing less than Christ. Our hope is not in our obedience to the Bible. Our hope is not in our ability to keep our wedding vows. Our hope is in Christ. If you have a good marriage, guess what? That will not save you. A good marriage will not save you from eternal hell. Your outward law-keeping will smell of rebellion and wickedness on the day of judgment if it's done to earn Christ's approval, to earn salvation. It will smell that way. The good news of the gospel is Christ, the one who fulfilled the law and kept his promise, lived and died for us. All of us have sinned, Paul said, but God, rich in mercy because of the great love with which he loved us, made us alive together with him. Many of you may have broken your marriage vows, but know this, Christ, the great promise keeper, will never leave, he will never forsake, and he will never divorce his church. So church, our hope is in him. Our hope's in him. Some of you are married, but you've never truly recognized the significance of your marriage, that it's God's idea that actually tells of the gospel story. And maybe it's because, well, you don't know the gospel. You don't know Jesus. Can I tell you, the Bible says that repentance of your sin and faith in the person of Jesus, that he's the true Son of God, the second person of the Trinity, and faith in the work of Jesus, that he was born of a virgin, that he lived the life that we couldn't live and died the death we deserved and rose from the grave in victory because God approved of his sacrifice on our behalf. Faith in the person and work of Christ leads to your salvation. Paul would say, today is the day of salvation. Some of you listening in may not know Christ as your Savior, and I want to encourage you. I want to encourage you to see your sin for what it is, but in a greater way than see Christ for what he's done and lean into him in faith and find forgiveness and find hope and find a family in God. You know, I know this topic has opened the door to many hurts. I've only had 30 minutes to walk through it, and I know you have many questions and many concerns. I don't have the ability in that time frame to speak to all of those things. I just don't. I do want to say this. If you feel unsafe in your marriage, or you feel that your kids are unsafe in your marriage, now's the time. Today, right now is the time to contact us and let us help you. The church, Christ himself wants you to be safe. And we want to walk with you and help navigate with you what that may look like. So if you find yourself in that place, just know, talk to us now. Do not wait. Do not hesitate. We are here for you. Now, for all those other questions you may have that have been opened up because of this passage, let me say this. I'm a phone call away. If you want to come to my house and stand in my yard 6 feet away from me, that's fine too. I would love to talk to you, but you can call me, you can text me, you can send me a message, and I would love to answer any of the questions you may have because I know that it's opened up a lot. And Christ has a word for us. He wants us to seek and to stay together in our marriages because when we do, we tell the truth of Christ in that. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you for your word. We know it's a hard one to hear. God, we know there's a lot of truth there, and sometimes that's hard to bear. But God, we want to accept it, and we want to live in light of it. Give us the grace, give us the mercy to walk in this. God, I pray for my church family, for those who've listened to this message, that they would receive your word, but also know your comfort, and also know your mercy, and also know your grace. God, this sin is so prevalent in our world. It's touched all of us in some way. God, so help us live in light of your truth in a gracious way with one another. God, I pray for my church family. I pray for those who've listened in who may not be a part of this church. God, that you would help us press deeper into your gospel, into the truth of what you've done for us, so that we can find that safe and secure harbor in your Son from the judgment and from sin. Lord, we love you and we praise you. We thank you for your word. We pray these things in Christ's name. Amen. Well, guys, I mentioned last week at the end of the service that today was going to be a difficult one, but I'm thankful that you walked through this text with me. We look forward to the day we can be back together. It looks like it's going to be pushed out further than we imagined, but I encourage you to continue to talk to one another, continue to have your Zoom meetings. I know some of our Sunday school classes have been doing that. Continue to love one another as appropriate. Stay home, stay sheltered in, right? Save lives. We love you guys. God bless. Have a great day.